I love the season that we're in as a church. And I think it's really important for you to view life in terms of seasons. Things come and go. It's a season. And, you know, sometimes it's great to look for one of Scripture's metaphors to define your season. Scripture is going to always put out metaphors. It's always going to lay in front of us an analogy. It's going to put out a principle. And the lazy thinker says, oh, that sounds good. I get it. But the critical thinker says, where in my life have I seen that play out? So let's take one for example. The biblical principle, you reap what you sow. This is like Christianity's wink towards karma. You reap what you sow. Where in your life have you seen a situation where someone reaped what they sowed? Think about it. Most of us can call to mind moments where you've seen that play out. Wave at me if that's true. You're like, yeah, you reap what you sow. Well, in Scripture, there's all kinds of these things that help us think about life better and develop a more accurate worldview. The one that I find in this season, I would say, I sense in my heart for our church, for our staff, even just personally in my family, would be this, you know, idea of new wine and new wineskins. You ever seen this in the Bible? There come times where God makes it very clear, hey, I'm doing a new thing. I'm making ways in the wasteland. I'm making rivers in the desert. I'm doing things in places that you wouldn't expect. I'm doing something new. And a lot of times attached to that type of idea is this verbiage, new wine and new wineskins. God's doing something new. It seems to be readying us for what's ahead, that there's goodness in front of us, fulfillment in front of us, significance in front of us, that there should be an anticipation and an excitement and a positive outlook that says, no, this is a season of new wine and new wineskins. God's gonna do something cool. I feel that in my heart. If you were to walk through our staff locations where you get to be around our team, you would hear this heartbeat echo throughout our church. This is kind of a new wine, new wineskin type of season. And I just can't shake this thought, this pressing thought as your pastor, that some of you are stepping into the greatest season that you've ever had with Christ. I believe that. I believe that some of you are going to taste and see that the Lord is good. That's what the Bible says, that the proof in the pudding is in the tasting. Chocolate pudding looks like a lot of things. You have to put it to the taste test. Christianity looks like a lot of things, but it's not like all these other religions. Put it to the taste test. Our God is good. This is gonna be a season of his goodness. I find that in this series, I've really been, I don't know, I think I wrote, I put together this entire series to have this weekend's message. It's like I wanted to have this conversation with our church. I just knew it needed the 7 weeks to lead up to it. And I knew if I made that clear on the front end, most would check out. We find that when it comes to certain things, especially the book of Revelation, we can develop selective hearing. Anyone sitting next to someone who has selective hearing? And we can do that. And I would say, to call to mind maybe week one, to try to accelerate this forward. Week one, we said there's four primary readings, how you can read the book of Revelation. There's four theological camps. I would say to some degree all have merit. Two are definitely stronger than the others. That is preterism, idealism, historicism, and futurism. We don't have time to unpack all of them today. You got to go back to week one to check it out. But just to give you the cliff notes, preterism believes that everything we read in the book of Revelation is behind us. It's already taken place, that we shouldn't be reading this text with anticipation, looking to what's going to happen ahead of us. I think that comes with a massive blind spot. and then you don't know what's coming your way. The next is idealism, which says that the book of Revelation is all art. It's all metaphors, all analogy, and you can make it mean what you want it to mean. This is actually much of the problem of our current reading of Scripture. Our question has changed. The question now is, what does this mean to me? Well, that doesn't matter. It doesn't even matter what it means to me. The question is, what does it mean? What is the author saying? Not what your preferences accommodate, not what your feelings can handle, not our opinions, not my theological training. No, what does it mean? If you were to like extract the bias, and you were to extract the emotions, and you were to extract all the just clouded thinking when it comes to this stuff, if you look at it and you say, okay, what does it mean? Okay? And the idealism camp really takes far too much creative liberty when it comes to their theology. The historicism camp is a wonderful camp. It's the camp that says much of what we read in the book of Revelation can be recognized throughout human history. You can see this in history playing out, and it continues to play out. And they would say that some of it is still ahead of us. And I would say, without a doubt, we made it clear in week one, our church would be in the futurism camp, but we also have a strong appreciation for the historicism camp. That's where I would certainly be personally. The historicism camp views these seven letters that we've been reading and studying. It views these seven letters as seven historical eras within biblical history, church history. Does that make sense? So the historicism theological camp will say that we believe that these seven letters, yes, they're letters to churches, but we believe they also represent seven church historical eras, okay? So that's important for us to look at today. So watch this, and there's some overlap as they did this. But the first is the apostolic church. This is right after Pentecost, the Holy Spirit arrives, the church is launched, right? This is chapter one of church history. Much of you would benefit greatly if you took a season to focus on church history. You don't stand with confidence because you don't know our heritage. You don't know our story. The apostolic church is from 30 to 300 AD, and this was the letter to the church of Ephesus, right? Now watch how it plays out. Next is the martyr church, which was the church in Smyrna, the church that was facing persecution. So the church is birthed and it's immediately facing persecution. It's almost immediately part of the story. Adversity is always a part of the story. Goes to the next one, which is the compromising church, the church of Pergamum, and that was from 314 to 590 AD. I'll put this out on social media so you can have it. Just stay with me. I'm gonna make the final thought is what's most important. The next is the Roman Catholic Church. Now this is great to pause because this is from 590 to 1517 AD. Now this is noticeable history. Right, when you talk about the apostolic church, you talk about the martyr church or the compromising church, I personally, I don't know what your historical exposure has been, but I can't call to mind a lot of things about that historical part of history. But when it comes to the Roman Catholic Church, now it's a noticeable history. Oh, I think I'm starting to gain some familiarity now, right? So the Roman Catholic Church explodes. Constantine gives his life to Christ in the fourth century. Suddenly now the church has rights and power and resources and now marches forward with shields holding crosses. The Romans advanced the cause of Christ. The very empire that once tried to stomp it out picked up the cross and started to walk it out. That's crazy. But there was corruption in their heart and that got exposed eventually. And here's what happens next. is the Reformation Church. This is 1517 to 1700 where Martin Luther, you know, puts pen to pad and thus becomes the Reformation. That for us who are Protestants, we are the byproduct of this moment in church history, the Reformation Church, the Great Schism. You should read about this. This is where we adhere to a gospel that declares and celebrates that we are justified by faith in Christ, and faith alone. It is by his grace that we are saved. So following the Reformation Church is the Revival Church, right? All my charismatics said amen. And it's from 1700 to 1900, right? And this was the church in Philadelphia, where I think you could even look at America and you could say, yeah, without a doubt, the late 1900s appears to be and may forever be the pinnacle of evangelicalism within America. You could say that's true. That revival-like momentum within our nation probably reached its peak towards the end of the 1900s, 80s and 90s, which would leave the final letter, the worldly church, which is from 1900 to the rapture, right? And that's the letter we're gonna look at today. So if you adhere to the historicism camp, which I think there's a lot of merit in it, which time of history are we living in? The last one. And individuals will ask me, Pastor, do you think we're living in the last days? And I'm always hesitant because I don't feel in myself the confidence that I see in others when they're teaching on this stuff. I have no confidence in my ability to predict what year he's coming back, let alone what month, week, or day. Those who predict the rapture down to the very moment amaze me. That I do not possess that audacity. I would say where I do feel confident in my belief in view of this stuff is, without a doubt, I believe we're in the final era, 100%. And I think you can make a pretty sound case for that without being super dramatic. And I think if you're looking at these letters now and you say, okay, we got them all on the table. Again, think subjectively. Like, be able to set aside your emotions, set aside your assumptions, and just think, what does the text mean? What do these letters have in common? What are the literary themes that just, they come to the surface? And the one thing all seven of these churches had in common was they were churches living under severe pressure. It's the one thing they had in common. Every single one of them was living in times that came with pressure. And every single one of them received a letter from God addressing their current circumstances and how he seeks to work in and through their lives. But they're all going through pressure. And the question is, well, how? Like, what kind of pressure? Sometimes we try to make the questions too sophisticated. No, ask obvious questions. They're going through pressure. How? Like, what's the pressure? And suddenly you start to realize, oh, there's three forms of pressure that are at play in all these letters. And the first form is what? The Roman Empire. There's no question the Roman Empire is a significant form of pressure, obstacle, and resistance to the gospel. There's no question about it. They had multiple wicked Caesars and emperors, and we talked about their destruction and hostility towards the church. There's no question some of the pressure was the Roman Empire. Revelations in code fashion refers to the Roman Empire as Babylon. When you read through it, when he's referring to Babylon, he's referring to the Roman Empire. And that would represent what? What kind of pressure would Rome represent? All right, so if you're thinking cause and effect, we're gonna separate these. What kinds of pressure are we facing? what's the causes and what is that producing, okay? So watch. If you go to causes, the Roman Empire would represent the institutional pressure. There's a governmental pressure, an administrative pressure. There's an institutional pressure. That's if you're just looking at it very obviously. Okay, one thing that they're facing is an institutional pressure. In addition to that, there's a social pressure. Every single one of these cities that these churches are in existed long before the gospel ever arrived. What does that mean? That means from day one, the very first Christian in that community would have lived in a culture that had its origin, traditions, wrapped up, tied in, and immersed within its culture and society with all of its belief systems, values, cultural traditions, societal norms. There would have been an immediate social pressure that everything about the culture would have been running against the grain of the church. The first Christian would have immediately found this is going to be difficult. There would have been a social pressure. Everything about the culture stood in contradiction to what this community of believers was to represent. And that's a real thing. There's social pressure. And some will say, well, Pastor, like, do you think we live in times where there's social pressure? Yeah. Right? Of course there's social pressure. You know, we all can relate to this. So the third is the physical pressure. And what we see in these letters is these churches were literally going through physical persecution. Much of what is lost on the American church is we don't take into consideration that the majority of Christians around the world face life and death persecution every single day. Physical threats every single day. That's not our reality. I would have no qualification to speak to that type of experience. It's not been my own. So I think when you look at this letter, I would say, well, I don't really think we can maybe do justice in the third conversation for us. But do we recognize the top two in our current situation? Well, of course. Okay, so if you're thinking, all right, well, if we're looking at it from a historicism view, and we find ourselves in this final era as a church facing these pressures, what did those pressures cause? What tendencies did they create in the body of believers? Because here's what we're gonna start to realize. What are the pressures we're facing? What are they creating in the body of believers? Again, you have to put emotions aside, otherwise you can't handle the pressure of the conversation. What were they creating? Okay? And why would we want to know that? Because Jesus is about to say something to them that is going to help them with that problem. And so it's again saying, all right, if that's us, let's identify it, humble ourselves, and open ourselves up to his word, because maybe, just maybe, Jesus is going to say something to us that is meant to help us. Okay? What were in the letters the three effects of the pressure? So we know the Roman Empire, we know there's social pressure, we know that there was physical pressure. What was that producing in the body of Christ? And the first, without a doubt, was a logical misstep. This is where this pressure starts to produce bizarre, unproductive thinking within the community of faith. Think about the letters. What is he addressing? Hey, you've given yourself over to false truth, false teachers, false prophets. He even refers to a group of people in the church as the synagogue of Satan. We've talked about, in other words, he's saying there's a group of people who are now being pastored by the devil. Well, what is one of the devil's number one aliases and definers? The father of lies. He says there are people who are now being pastored by the father of lies. It seems like it's coming from a good place, but it is meant to manipulate you. And we are becoming far too casual in our open-mindedness. I just think what is being revealed is we are allowing things to so fundamentally change in the way in which we think. The worldviews, the paradigms that we have always been rooted in, we're now tampering with. And suddenly there's a bizarre, well, here's the thing. What comes into your mind will eventually come out through your life. And those who don't learn to manage the space between the ears have a hard time managing their years, managing their life, right? So it's like, okay, this pressure, if we're going to experience it the way they experienced it, this pressure is going to cause us to get tripped up in our thinking. Have you, over the past few years or even in the recent months, felt a little tripped up in your thinking with some of the pressures that you're dealing with? Yes. Again, you just got to think about it more neutrally. So there's a logical downside to this. Where else does it show up? Sexual. Now, we're not going to spend too much time here. I think we've provided plenty of clarity on this over the past few months. I would say the one thing that maybe I would tag on to the final statements of the sexual conversation is perhaps the biggest blind spot and foolish judgment within the local church is we have conveniently dismissed and excused all heterosexuals from the sexual immorality conversation. As if there's not filth in that camp. So we have to understand that the pressures we face in the world fundamentally and almost immediately, some of the early symptoms are going to be managing my mind and thinking correctly, and two, stewarding my sexuality. Now, here's the thing. If you're not a Christian, you can agree with me on this, that we all understand that fundamentally, your mind and your sexuality shape the trajectory of your life. They have massive influence in your life. If you do not learn to manage those things well, your life is not going to go well for you. So at a minimum, you owe it to yourself. If you're not a Christian, that's fine. You just owe it to yourself to give strong consideration to the things you adhere to in your mind and the ways in which you casually steward your sexuality. We all, if we're just wanting to be wise people, would say, well, yeah, those two things are important. We should be more mindful, right? And then lastly, there is a relational side effect. We mismanage our minds, we mismanage our sexuality, and we mismanage our relationships. When a culture is defined by polarization and division, you could say the summary to that would be a mismanagement of relationship. When we come into pressure, we allow things in our character to be compromised, and then it comes out into our relationships. And it's like, okay, here we go. Pastor's leaning in. Because here's the thing, we say often, you know, throughout this series, if you read the book of Revelation, and it doesn't put some hope within your heart, a smile upon your face, and some steel within your spine, you're not reading it well. And I know what you're thinking. Well, Pastor, there's not a smile in this room. Right? Where comes the point where we go, oh, okay, I get it now. And maybe this is the part in the whole series that it's like, maybe that'll make you smirk. Right? What does he say to this church? Here it is. If we got the text, go to the final letter. Let's say this is God talking to us in the final era, a church that is facing pressures, institutional, social, right? Not physical in our context. Facing the challenges that come with those. Here's what he says. To the angel of the church in Laodicea write, these are the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the ruler of God's creation. I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot, and I wish, think about that. I don't know if there's another time in scripture where Jesus makes a wish. I sometimes think wishful people are wasteful people, and I wonder if in this moment Christ is in any way being wasteful. It's like, I wish, I don't have a ton of confidence that you're gonna listen to me. I wish you would. You were either one or the other. So because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I'm about to spit you out of my mouth. The original language for that word spit is to vomit. Like Jesus is writing so firmly with this church that is in the last era. So firm. He says, you say I am rich, I have acquired wealth and do not need a thing. But you do not realize that you are, watch this haymaker combination. Wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. That's a combination. That's a solid jab with a right hook followed by an uppercut, then another haymaker to top it off with an illegal roundhouse kick to the face. TKO, you are, look at this, wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. Yeah, none of us are smiling. He goes on to tell us, I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire so you can become rich and white clothes to wear, so you can cover your shameful nakedness and salve to put on your eyes so you can see. Those whom I love. Now let's play the telephone game. You ever like told a story as a group? Everybody gets two words. You get two words, you get two words, you get two words, and we pass it on down and we just let the story develop. So one person says, in the, and the next person says, beginning we, and the third person says, went swimming. In the beginning, we went swimming. And as it builds, you get to influence the story. If you got to choose the next few words, to those whom I love, what would you say? To those whom I love, I encourage. To those whom I love, I bless. To those whom I love, I serve. To those whom I love, I provide for. To those whom I love, I'm gentle with, I'm patient. If you had the next two words, what would you say? Watch what Jesus says. To those whom I love, I rebuke and discipline. So be earnest and repent. Here I am, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the doors, I will come in and eat with that person and they with me, because he's a gentleman. He works by invitation, not by invasion. He will not pry or force his way into your life. You have to welcome him in. To the one who is victorious, I will give the right to sit with me on my throne, just as I was victorious and sat down with my Father on his throne. Whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. And again, you're already thinking, this guy's gonna have us here till Tuesday. Too much to cover. This is why you have to be in a life group. You owe it to yourself to go deeper into this stuff. It's great for all of us. But the thing that I wanna maybe focus on a little bit is just the overall theme, that the issue that he has with them is that they're lukewarm. How do you discover if you're lukewarm? How do you make that self-assessment? How do you evaluate well as a follower of believers? You don't have to make it known, but I think healthy people, wise people embrace brutal facts, not blind spots. Like, how can I just assess better? And so you can turn it into a spectrum from a scale of 1 to 10, and just maybe an annual good exercise for you is to say, hey, I'm just going to give some basic evaluation. I wouldn't overthink this, don't overdo it. This is just my way of thinking. But just say, in terms of basic Christian living, how am I doing? And is it causing me to become a lukewarm Christian? So you could look at it like this, in terms of scripture's instruction. Are you a part of communal worship? Like, how consistently do you gather with a body of believers? This is where online is a great supplement, but it can never be a substitute. You cannot neglect the gathering of the saints. Two, genuine fellowship. Like, are you growing in sincere relationship with those who are a part of your faith community? You owe it to yourself to be engaged relationally. And the question is am I growing in genuine fellowship? Much of your spiritual journey is going to be marked, accelerated, and enriched by your relationships with others in the body of Christ. Three, biblical stewardship. Do you steward your resources the way God instructs us to? Recently, I was asked a question, Pastor, the verses always say tithes and offerings. Tithes and offerings, what does that even mean? And I said, well, tithes refers to the tenth. They would give at a starting point 10% of their income back to God, acknowledging that he owns all things. And then beyond that, they would give offerings. By biblical instruction, it is not an offering until it's above 10%. That's what the clarifier is if you're looking for it. He goes on to say, faithful servanthood in scripture is always this call to serve others. And the route to significance, it is marked with service. There's a servanthood piece to it. In addition to that, there's sexual purity. Am I living a pure life? Next to that would be intentional prayer. Do I just talk to God passively, or are there focused times in my day where I have a reverent conversation with the creator of my life? Not just like, God is great, God is good. No, like, God, I need you. I am fully dependent on you. Like a sincere conversation with him. And lastly, are you a responsible student? Folks, like, there's no question. In the world that we live in, you're not going to be able to follow Christ if you don't develop discernment. If you do not become a student yourself, you can't ride the coattails of me talking to you 40 minutes a week. There's just a studiousness that comes to this faith of saying, hey, I want to be a student of God's word. And if you look at this, just between you and God, you don't have to show anyone. Burn the paper when you're done. Just assign a number to each and then take the sum average and say, on a scale of 1 to 10, am I thriving in my faith or am I just stalled out? Am I lukewarm? And what's amazing is the question is, well, if we are lukewarm, so say we all go home and we do this and we find, oh, I'm a 4. The first thing I would say is do not take on a bunch of shame. If right now you feel ashamed, I'm not communicating well. That's not what you should be thinking. You should be thinking, okay, like, I appreciate the clarity. What do I do now? If I'm lukewarm, I appreciate the clarity. What do I do now? And what's Jesus' solution? And Jesus says, I will put salve on your eyes. I'm going long and apologize to everyone who this is going to impact. For those who want to stay, I got to get this thought out. I put salve on their eyes. Here's the question, and I've been asking this myself because I'm getting older. Is bad eyesight something you should pray for, against? Like, is eyesight an injury or is it something else? And my son and I have been talking, like, hey, should we be praying? Like, God, would you heal our eyes? Like, is it an injury that he heals? And I'll go down this wormhole of optometry where they don't view eyesight as an injury, as something you heal. They view it more mechanically as something you can fix. Think about the difference. Something you fix or something you heal. So Christ comes and he clearly wants to help them see something better. I'm going to help you see. And he decides to assign a very loaded metaphor to it. He doesn't say, hey, I'm going to come and I will grab a wrench and I will fix your eyes. He says, no, I will grab a salve and I will heal your eyes. Do eyes need to be healed? That's the question. And all week I've just been like, man, what is it about eyes needing to be healed? And then you start to realize, oh, because everybody is walking around this world viewing everything through the filters of pain. We view church through the filters of pain, marriage through the filters of pain, sports, school, education, peers, siblings, parents, through the filter of pain. People from all different categories who give us triggers because we view the situation through the filters of pain. And he's saying, yeah, I will come to those who view everything through the filter of pain, and I will begin to heal their eyes. In other words, he's saying, part of your problem is the way you see things. And the moment you could see them differently, you would be better off. So the question is, if God's gonna heal our eyes, what does he want us to see? What does he want us to see? And it comes back to that statement, those whom I love, I what? Rebuke and discipline. We don't think of rebuke and discipline as an act of love. It's why you've not smiled yet. Because for us, a rebuke and discipline hurts our feelings, not builds our appreciation. We don't see it as, why don't we see his rebuke and discipline as an act of love? Why don't we see that? And here's why. Because none of us know anyone in our life who perfectly, unwaveringly will never give you anything other than unadulterated feedback. Our God only gives us unadulterated feedback. We're used to people who have hidden motives. We're used to people who have an agenda, right? We are so accustomed to people having other plans and trying to shape our life and get something out of us and what's their desired outcome in my life. So we just assume that God himself has hidden motives as well. So when God rebukes us, we think he's abusive like other abusive people in our life. When God rebukes us, we think it's because he's holding us back from experiencing our full potential like the insecure people in my life. We attach it to that. No, what he's saying is you gotta get to a point where as God heals your eyes, you begin to see his rebuke and his discipline as an act of love. Where when God rebukes you, you respond in appreciation. Oh my goodness, I don't want to be a lukewarm Christian. But as your pastor, my goodness, I should probably publicly repent. My life sometimes gets hit with distractions. In the last 4 to 6 months, I mean, I've had some distractions that can sometimes bump you off, right? And I'd be lying to you if I didn't say, hey, there were times in my life where I got out of rhythm with some of my spiritual disciplines. And God, I'm so thankful that your word kept pressing in, rebuking and disciplining and calling me to just an earnest life of repentance. That's what we're missing in the repentance conversation is the earnest emphasis. It's just an earnest thing. And the question is okay, what does he want us to see and hear with appreciation as an act of love? And it's verse 17. You are, or do you not realize that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked? Whoa! You want us to receive that with appreciation. And he's like, once your eyes are healed, you certainly will. Anyone believe that God still heals? I just think there's a lot of people with a lot of pain and it's shaping their outlook on life. And we recently, for fall break, wanted to take our kids on a trip to give them a church experience where they didn't have to be pastor's kids. Hey, let's just go do something like as a family. I always want them to experience things I experienced growing up that were formative to who I am. And so we took them to a predominantly black church conference in Los Angeles. It was amazing. For a revival night, it was incredible. We were there and they had this whole merchandise area. My daughter really wanted to get this hoodie and she's been kind of clinging to it because most of you know my daughter battles seizures and it's become a whole thing and she's doing really well with it. And so recently she had a pretty bad seizure. And so we were at our scan this week and here's my daughter tied for second with most beautiful person on the planet. Her mom is in a league of her own, but she's gorgeous. This is Riley. And she's got this hoodie on that says Jehovah Rapha. And Jehovah Rapha means my God heals. And I don't know what your situation is entirely. I know we all have things that mark our vision with pain. I know we're all caring situations, but in our house, we still believe that my God heals. We still believe that our God is faithful. We still believe that God does amazing things, even through the pain and agony of life. And so I do want to leave you with this. What is the courageous question? Am I the type of person who receives with appreciation a rebuke from God? That's the courageous question. And may we all kind of humbly ask it this week, amen. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, God, we thank you for your goodness. And God, I'm thankful for this group's patience. Too many announcements from me on the front and I can't get it all in sometimes. But God, I do ask that you would help us be a good church. I humbly just ask that you'd help us be a solid church. God, would you anchor our vision towards a better church and help us not to obsess over simply becoming a bigger church. God, would you develop something in us and through us, and God, would you keep us open to all that your truth has in store for us. And God, I believe we're stepping into an amazing season as a church, and God, would you ready us with anticipation for whatever that looks like, and we trust that you will go before us and you will extend to us whatever influence and impact you think we can handle. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Church, enjoy your week.